Well, thanks for joining me. Thanks for being here. At this time, when I looked at the schedule 2 days ago, I had actually no idea I was going to give this talk. So it's going to be interesting. And also, there's like 3 talks I would like to see right now, so thanks for being here. It's select distinct features from databases where type in SQL or NoSQL. So the idea is we're going to talk about SQL or NoSQL features, try to compare them. It's not going to give you a straight answer, like SQL's better, NoSQL's better, I need SQL, I need NoSQL. At the end of the talk, you should probably go out with more questions than hopefully you had in the beginning. So this is me. My name is Laurent Dauguin. I'm a developer advocate and I work for Couchbase. Couchbase is an open source NoSQL mobile key value SQL database. We do lots of stuff. And I will give you some example during the talk. You can follow me on Twitter, you can send me an email. I'll be around today. So feel free to ask me any questions at the end of the talk, during the talk, or during the afternoon. I'll be available. So we're going to start by resetting expectation. When people talk about SQL databases, usually they talk about RDBMS, which is different. You know, SQL is a structured query language, all right? And here we're here to talk about databases. So most of the SQL databases are actually called relational database management system, and they're called relational database management system because you store stuff the relational way, which basically means you normalized everything into tables and columns. So when we talk about SQL database, we talk about RDBMS. And it's really interesting. You have to keep that in mind. SQL database usually is RDBMS. It's important because now most NoSQL database do SQL, which is weird, but you know that's part of the reason why we're here. So relational model, you have table, you have columns, you have tuples. When you do a SQL query, you get tuples back. NoSQL database, on the other hand, started by saying this is everything that's non-SQL. Doesn't mean it's not relational. Doesn't mean you cannot do SQL. Although it started by this. It basically means anything else that is not relational. So in the world of databases, you have RDBMS and you have the other stuff. The other stuff are all under one banner, which is NoSQL. Now that this is fine, we're gonna play a game of differences and start talking about difference between SQL and NoSQL. And the first one that comes up, the most obvious one, is NoSQL means not SQL. It started out like this. I think it was one of the first meetup somewhere in the Silicon Valley. Someone said, well, you cannot do SQL, so it's called that NoSQL. It used to be true. Like, there is no way you could actually do SQL with the first NoSQL databases, the first generation. The first generation of NoSQL database actually goes back to the 1960s and actually older than RDBMS, which is interesting. And that being said, it started by being defined as NoSQL. Now you can do SQL-ish or actual SQL queries, depending on you know other stuff. So saying that NoSQL means not SQL, it's a trap. It's not true. Examples. Some NoSQL store. I work for Couchbase. We have a query language called NQL. NQL is a superset of SQL. So everything that you can write in SQL and C92, which is like an old SQL for the 90s, you can actually write it with NQL. So the first query is select an album and title from playlist where artist equals Metallica, that's the name of my band when I was in high school, and gives you the result as JSON. NQL is SQL with other stuff. You can do joins, you can do subselect, you can do you know all the things you expect from SQL. It's on JSON data, and it returns a JSON answer. So it's a NoSQL database that allows you to do SQL. So yes, not SQL, not true anymore. It's not only SQL now. Cassandra SQL. Cassandra is a column store. You can run SQL-like query. It's the exact same one than NQL. It looks like SQL. It will return a data set, data result as tuples, just like any SQL database, because Cassandra is basically one SQL database with one big table with full of columns. Another query language that allow maybe not the same expressivity that you get with SQL, structured query language allow you to express many constraints, many query constraints in just one simple query. Here it's a little different. It's mostly where close. I'm doing a find. Give me everything that has artist equals Metallica, and then the other JSON I give is this is the field I want. I want the field album. I want the field title. Now, if you're like me and you have experience with SQL, well, there's probably some here that you prefer than others. And I'm not a big Mongo fan. And then the SQL driver, most of those NoSQL databases actually have JDBC driver, ODBC driver, which means that if you have a JDBC driver, you're pretty much SQL and you can do SQL stuff. So not SQL is not a valid difference. Every database, whether you're RDBMS or NoSQL, can do SQL query, which again is weird, I know, but that's how it is. And then the other thing you hear a lot is NoSQL is schemaless. RDBMS, there's a schema because you have table, you have column, you need to think about it first, and NoSQL, supposedly you're not supposed to do it. So you're moving from having structured data, to having, which is what schema does, to have unstructured data, which is having no schema or not really any schema. What is structured data? Well, this is a shape sorter. It's a game. You can fit all these pieces of wood into one particular place. So it's basically typed. You cannot put the square in the circle, it doesn't work like this. So this is a structured data store. This also is a structured data store with some knives. I use the knife example because it's easier for me to introduce you to unstructured data store. Structured data store, I have some kind of knife, they can only go into one place. And then they're all predefined. Like with this block knife, I cannot have a new fancy knife that's completely different that will fit in there. Not possible, never gonna happen. With an unstructured knife block, well, you can fit pretty much any kind of knife you would want in there. So no schema. Doesn't mean there's no information about what you're storing. You can probably recognize them based on the handle. I mean, it's not completely schemaless. Let's call that semi-structured. And it's great to have some schemaless stuff because you can do pretty much what you want, and you can store anything. And then yes, it doesn't work anymore because you forgot what you stored, or you have no way to actually get out what you stored in that unstructured data store. So schemaless is great, but are they really, really, really schemaless? Well, not really. This is a small example of something that I want to show you. It's called True Schemaless Database. It happens when you have no idea what you're storing at all. And some data store, like Couchbase, allow you to do this. And I'm going to show you a quick example, a quick query of something like this. I'm going to start by selecting every repositories from default, which is the name of the bucket where I'm storing stuff. And I just want one because I just want to show you the actual, of course, it's the new effect and it doesn't work. The actual structure where repositories is not missing because you don't have table and column. So if you have JSON, maybe you have some JSON document that don't actually have the repositories field. It happens. Again, there's no rigid schema, but there is some sort of inferred semi-schema. If I ask for the repositories object, I get a repositories thing. And what's a repository? It's an array of stuff. In this array of stuff, I have another object called languages. I know exactly how to go to repositories.languages. Repository 0.languages give me the languages object of the first repositories. There's an array and then goes on and on. And I actually have no idea what's in there, which means that it's kind of schemaless. You have a schema on a JSON document because you have a field, they have a name, they have a type. Here, they do. There is field, there is a name, there is a type. Problem is, I have no idea what the name is. I don't really know, before storing the data, how I'm supposed to access that. So I'm kind of in this weird situation where I have no idea what field I can query. And what I want to do is, based on all the repositories, I want to see which language is the most used. So I want to get into an object that has a sub-object called repositories, which is actually an array of repositories, that has an object called languages, that has another object, which values, I have no idea what they are. And you can actually do that. And it's gonna be freaking slow because I have too much data on a small computer. It's fine. So there you go, you have the name of the language, the number of repository that had the language, and the total number of bytes that were written. So if you followed quickly what I just showed you, you might have seen that there is an array. How do we access an array in a SQL query? That, you know, several things you can do. So let's forget about the select for a minute. And let's talk about the from query. From default. Default is called a bucket in Couchbase. This is where we store documents. It's like a namespace, just like a table. So in my very big table of objects, I can use the unnest keyword. And what the unnest keyword is going to do is take my array and then move it in the same namespace. So it's going to flatten my first array of repositories. And in repositories, I have this thing called repo languages, which is an object of stuff that I don't know. So I can call the object pairs function, and for the field name and the field value, it's going to send me an object with a field called name, and name is going to be the field name, and a field called value, and value is going to be the field value. It's going to be an array, so I can unnest this again, so flatten that array again, and then, you know, I can just group by language name, ordered by number of bytes, and just give me 10 answer, and that's pretty much what you see in the result. I asked for account, the language name, and the value, the sum of all the total bytes in the field. I had no idea what it was, and I can actually query it. So this is kind of true schemaless thing. So that was just to show you a bit of true schemaless things. So yes, NoSQL is schemaless. SQL isn't. Well, it used to be true again, but not anymore. Oracle has a great JSON type. Postgres has a great JSON type. Postgres has an amazing JSON type. MySQL as well. SQL Server, they have their own SQL, their own JSON stuff. There's DocumentDB, which is like the same version in the cloud, to use Microsoft databases to store JSON. So, you know, it kind of works. But that SQL language to query this non-native object that is JSON in an RDBMS, it gives you a I'm not going to say a weird-looking query because it's not as weird as MongoDB, but basically what you see here is a Postgres query. Tweets is a column where you store a JSON document. And so you need to use this arrow to say, give me the field called retweet status, and it's going to be text, give me the field called retweeted status, user, and it's going to be the name, etc., etc. And this way you can see who has tweeted the most. I just need to actually load those tweets before doing the query. And I should be able to show you some example of queries, of interesting queries. The query I just showed you in the slide, I'm going to run it in NQL, and what it's doing is giving you the most retweeted tweet for Java days. Just need to make sure that I'm actually using the right bucket. And this should give me, there's no S, Jada, and this should give me the most retweeted tweet of the conference, and this is from Brendan Macaber, and it's 23 retweets, my style from Java Days 2016 on Lagom are online. So What you see here, what you see better now here, is the same query that I just showed you before with Postgres, but with, you know, it's a native JSON store, so you don't have to use this arrow and everything. So it is actual SQL, but you know, it's maybe a little more readable than this one that had all this arrow and double arrow and type as well. I mean, there was, you know, more stuff. Doesn't mean it's less or more powerful. There's one that's more readable than the others because one started doing JSON after the other. But you know, it still works. So no, schema-less is not a valid difference when you talk about SQL or RDBMS on a SQL database, because they can all be schema-less to an extent. They can all be semi-structured because they can all store JSON. So it's not a valid difference anymore. So you know, what are the actual difference when it comes to storing data and querying data? And basically, there's different families of database that store things a different way, and basically the way you store stuff allow you to query it efficiently in a different way. So why are we all using SQL-like stuff? Because you know, when the SQL started, there was no SQL and it was fine. There was no SQL support and people were happy. I mean, you know, it worked. And gradually they've been adding more and more SQL-like language, whether it is SQL on NoSQL database or whether it is schema-less or semi-structured data on RDBMS. And there's one very good reason for that, is that everybody's used now to basically ask questions and know which question to ask. This is how SQL works, and this is probably how you've been working your whole career. Like, the where clause is pretty much playing the guess who game of, does your person is wearing a hat? No, then remove all the person with a hat. Does it have a big scar on his face? Yes, well, okay, I know who it is. And that's just a wear clause, and that's, you know, exactly why people like SQL so much. We are used to do it, and that's why it's coming in gradually. So let's talk about the data store houses, the data store family. The first one I want to talk about is a key value family, and I'm not gonna use the word database, I'm gonna use the word data store, and because I will do a difference between the two. In a key value store, the value can be anything. It can be a string, it can be a JSON string. If it's a JSON string, then you have an inferred schema inside, a semi-structured schema. It could be a photo, it could be anything. And the key value store is too dumb to know how to retrieve data based on the value. It can only retrieve data based on the key, which means that you can only get one document for one key. If you send several keys, you can get several documents, but you cannot do queries. And that's the difference I will put between a data store and database, is that a data store, like a binary store or a key value store, you cannot run query. A database, you can run query. So if you have a key value store and you can run a query based on the value part, then you become a database. Example of key value store, Redis, Memcache, Couchbase started out as a key value store. They all evolved into having more and more and more features. I've associated the Targaryen house to key value store because key value store is stupidly efficient, just like a dragon. It's not very smart, it's just like, get there and get things done. So that's my view of key value family. Now let's talk about the document family. If you can do a query based on the value part, let's say the value is a JSON and you can query that JSON, then you become a database. So you can store any value you want. If the value is JSON, you can do query. There's different way of doing query in document family. CouchDB was one of the first mainstream document database. You could store JSON and you were building a materialized index, building what was called a view. A view is actually quite powerful. It's an incremental map reduce function that runs on all the documents in your database, in your key value store. And if you run a map reduce on all the elements of your key value store, you can build an index. And if you have an index, you can do a query. And if you are a query, you're a document database. So map reduce, it's easy. A map, it's a function that takes an element and that allows you to do something. The only thing it's allow you to do in CouchDB or Couchbase is add an entry to an index or several entries to an index, and then the reduce part just take the whole index and send you just one value. So if you have a document with a field called date, then you can create an index based on the date field, so you can do a query based on the dates. And if you want to know how many documents you have, then you can just return the size of the index, and that's the reduce, and that's how you can do basic query stuff. So that was one way of doing query with documents. MongoDB had the MongoQL thing, because MongoDB is a document database, Cachebase is a document database, CacheDB is a document database. And so Cachebase had the views, and now we have this thing called Nicol, which is basically just like SQL. It's quite efficient as well. It can do many things. Maybe not the Lannister has not the best family to describe them, but all right. And then you have the column family. The most famous example is Cassandra. Cassandra stores everything into one big fat table of columns. Now it's not completely schemaless. There's actually a schema in there. You can use the word strong if you're positive. You can use the word rigid if you're negative. There is a schema, and you can do SQL-like query. And you know these things have been around for a while. It's great for big data stuff. It's not just Cassandra. There's Hashbase and many other usually big data identified database. So I said, okay, let's use Stark. And then there's the graph family. Graph, basically, they do one thing and they do it well, which is storing data as a graph. It's not a key value store. It's not a column store. It's not an RDBMS. It stores triplets of objects. There's an object. Let's call that a subject. A subject has a relation to the topic. The relation has a name. So Laurent is friend with Arun Gupta, which is my boss, if you know Arun. I'm sure you know Arun, some of you know Arun. So that's an example of triplets, and a graph database is just made of all these things, and you store document this way, because when you do a graph query, you want to know who is friend with who, and then who is friend with this guy, that is friend with this guy, and who are the friend of, you know, you can do graph queries. And it's much more efficient to express some queries using a graph than using a ridiculous amount of joins and subqueries. So, you know, graph, they do one thing very well, and that's why I've chosen the Greyjoy family. They do, I'm sure you guys know Game of Thrones. I don't even know if actually that's worse in talking about Game of Thrones. But, and then there's the RDBMS family, the Google database. We store everything in table. We use SQL queries. We do JSON as well, because we're not going to die like this. This is the Baratheon family, which, you know, doesn't exist anymore in the world of Game of Thrones, but still exists in the real world, and is still a very valid and important thing to use. It really depends on your use case. So this is more of a, you know, the slide will be online. You can check this out later on, but that's pretty much what I've said in one table. So basically, the way you store or you index stuff defines how you can query them. If you store stuff or index them as a graph, then you can do super powerful graph query. If you store stuff with a MapReduce index, then you can do exactly the query, the index for the query you want. It's the exact thing. And sometimes it's actually easier to express something complicated with a map function than with a SQL query. So it depends. Most of the databases, RDBMS or NoSQL, have one way to store things, and then they have different way of doing indexes. And because they have different way of doing indexes, they offer you different query capability, and that's why they all converging into one thing. But basically, queryability is a valid difference. Now, one of the other stuff I hear a lot is that SQL has search. By search, I mean full-text search. This very transverse stuff that actually allow you to create what is called an inverse index. So let's say you have some text and you want to know which word comes in. I'm searching for Java, and I'm storing a bunch of GitHub issues. I'm sure the Java word comes up in many GitHub issues. And I'm going to set fuzziness parameters to 2. Full text allow you to do fuzzy search. If you do a mistake in the word, then it will give you, you know, it will work even if you do mistakes. If I tap Java, it will return and set fuzziness to 2. It will return days because, well, you know, fuzziness to 2 means you're entitled to 2 mistakes. And so basically, Dev and Java, I did 2 mistakes. I replaced G by D and E by A by E. it actually works. That's one example of why full text search is interesting. And you need very specific kind of index. It's called an inverse index. Basically, I have the ticket. I have the content of the ticket. For each word, I'm going to do a table. The key of the table will be the word. And the value of the table will be every document ID where this word is contained. And this is why when you type a word, it can very quickly give you which document has this particular word. There was a great talk by Philip Crane yesterday on full text search. It's probably going to be online, so if you want to know more about full text search, probably a great talk to start into. It's been all about RDBMS for a while, and now NoSQL database start doing full text search. Cachebase has full text search. Cassandra has different way to do full text search. I have no idea what Mongo is doing, but you know, normal databases and normal NoSQL database do this. RDBMS implement that in different ways. MySQL doesn't. You can only have one full text index in MySQL. I mean, maybe they've moved that limit, but that was the case some years ago when I did it. I know SQL Server doesn't allow transactions on full text index. You know, this kind of stuff. So full text is a valid difference, but it's kind of fading out. Everybody's doing full text now. And then if you're not doing full text, you can use Elasticsearch, you can use Solr, you can use, you know, there's countless other solutions that will do full text for you. Most of them are based on the Java project called Lucene. And you know, you can do it. It's fine. So now the other difference, the big one this time is, to me, is that NoSQL scales out and SQL doesn't. So what scale out or scale up mean? Scaling up. That's an example of scaling up. You start small, get bigger. Scaling out on the other end, you start alone and then you pray for not being alone, and finally you're not alone, you just scale out, there's more and more and more people coming to help you. So in the database world, it kind of worked like this. When you had too much load on a SQL database, what you were going to do is, well, let's move that to a bigger computer and let's add more hard disk and more CPU and more memory and everything. It worked until a point where actually having a very big, baby computer becomes much more expensive than scaling out, which means having several normal computers, which is what scale out is all about. So traditionally, RDBMS scale up, NoSQL scales out. It's true, but again, they can both scale vertically and horizontally. The problem is some will be harder to scale one way or the other. RDBMS scale out, it works. You can do it. There's different way you can do it. The most basic way to do it is to use a master-slave architecture where all the writes go into one node and all the reads go into some other node, and there's a replication because all the stuff you write on the master will be eventually replicated to the slave. Eventually. So maybe you do a query, you write something, and then you do a read, and maybe the change you did on the master hasn't been replicated fast enough when you do a read, so you have inconsistent data. It happens with some databases. Some will wait until everything is replicated and it will be strongly consistent. Some won't be. MongoDB isn't. Some SQL databases are. It's a matter of choices. Do you want the result now, and do you want it or do you want it consistent? If you want it now, it might be inconsistent. If you're okay to wait, you might have consistent result. That's the master-slave way of doing stuff. And then you can use sharding. Sharding would basically mean if I have two node or two master node, I will send 50% of my data here and 50% of the other data here. That's how Cachebase works. We do consistent hashing. We are a key value store. We have a key. If we hash that key, we have an internal ID. And we know that this internal ID, based on the number of machines you have on the cluster, corresponds to this particular machine, so we're going to write it in this particular machine. So that's how you do, how we do automatic sharding. It doesn't mean you cannot do it with other data store. And if you're willing to shard manually, Postgres scale out really well. It's just, well, you know, it's more work for you, which, you know, is fine, but it depends on what you want to do. And so talking about scaling out, enters, and master-slave architecture, or master-less architecture, enters the CAP theorem, which is consistency, availability, and partitioning. And what it says basically is when you're in a distributed system, if there is a network partition, which basically means if there's one of the machines in the cluster that's not here anymore, or the clusters are, let's say you have network issues and then you have three machines alone here and three machines alone there, what are you going to do? Are you going to try to be as consistent as possible, or are you going to try to be as available as possible? This is what the CAP theorem is all about. So if I take the Cassandra example, Cassandra is AP, availability in partitioning. If there's a partition issue, because in Cassandra you can replicate data, and basically in Cassandra you have every nodes are master or slave. So if one of the node falls down that had this particular data, I know it can still be accessed somewhere else. Might not be the most recent copy of it, because maybe it's not been replicated yet to the other node, but there is some data, so I'm going to send you that data right now, and that's being available over consistency. Now, catch base, if you have a node that's not there, we tell you, I cannot give you a consistent answer. The node where the active data was is not there anymore for some reason, so I'm telling you, this node is down. No consistent issue. That being said, it doesn't mean that you have to choose between the two. In cache base, if you want to be available, you can ask for the replicas on other nodes because it's distributed, so it's replicated. We have replicas. The difference is we want to make sure that the developer knows when he's actually asking for something that might not be consistent. So you know, you don't have to choose between C and A. It's just a matter of trade-off depending on the situation. And then there's the acid versus base difference. You all know, if you've been to computer science classes, what acid is, and I always forgot what it is, and I was going to say atomic consistent, durable, and the I stands for something else, isolation, which basically means you can do transaction on an RDBMS. It's not the case yet for NoSQL database. They're working on this. And basically base would be eventually consistent soft state. It's not a promise consistency, there's no transaction support. And then I touched that topic a little bit, talking about sharding. The developer experience differs between vertical or horizontal sharding, depending on the solution you use. If you use cache-based, the horizontal scaling, the sharding is done automatically. If you want to do that with Postgres, then you need to, you know, do that manually, which is fine. Again, it works, but it's some additional work. So yes, NoSQL scales out, but SQL, it scales out as well, as long as you're willing to put the effort. Now, there's something I hear a lot, and it's about application logic and RDBMS. You usually, traditionally, if you do an app and you use a SQL store, there's a decent chance that you have store procedure, you have triggers, you have security based on the column of your database, based on the role of the person connected to the database. And that's something that's super easy to do when you have a strong schema, because you know exactly who's connecting and what you're going to store. So you can actually enforce security rule. Now, if you think about the document database, the key value model, you only know that one guy is connected to one storing space and he can only store key value stuff. And you have no idea what the field could be, or I mean, it's so basically what it's saying is RDBMS have 40 years of advance into adding business logic into the database layer. NoSQL databases are lagging behind. It's not bad if you think about it. I mean, personally, as a developer that have been forbidden to touch any database in production because of the ops team, I am actually pretty happy to have all my application logic and business layer on my code than in somebody else's database that I don't have any right to touch. So separation of concerns. Some people prefer to put stuff in the database. Some people prefer to put business logic on database. Some don't. I personally don't. So it depends. Now, the other question that comes up with RDBMS and application logic And business code is, should you normalize or denormalize? If you're using an RDBMS, everything's normalized. There's no way around it. This is the exact definition of being an RDBMS. You store relational data, normalized data, into tables and columns, which is what you have here. If you use a key value store, a document database, well, what I just showed you before can be into just one object, and I've been denormalizing stuff, which basically means I'm duplicating data, but then I will get it much faster. There's a trade-off here, getting data faster, but keeping it up to date, well, there's different version of the same data in the same data store. So using key value allows you to either embed the data, which is put everything into a single object, or refer to the data, which is basically normalizing again with objects. And both are fine with SQL and NoSQL. So when should you embed stuff? Really, the only reason why, the only valid reason to embed stuff in something is because you want it to be fast, and yeah, that's the only reason, actually. And key value does it very well. And we have customers that work only with key value aspects of Couchbase. They don't do queries, they don't use anything like this. They just want to be fast, they embed everything. It's great when your data is not moving too much, when there's not too much duplication of data, because the more you denormalize and the more it moves, then the more you need to update it. So if I need to update an address, I need to update that address in the address documents and every other document that contains this address. So, you know, speed has a cost. And yes, denormalizing in SQL is fine. One of the problems we had in my previous company, we were using SQL. There wasn't a SQL database at the time, or it wasn't supported, and it was too slow. Because of relational model, you need to do joins and everything, it was slow. And the other way we had around this was basically using a cache. And if you think about it, denormalizing everything is just like creating a materialized view, a different view of the data, a single cache in SQL. That's what happened when you denormalize stuff, or that's what happened when you do materialized view. You're denormalizing. You're making sure that it's going to be faster. So, you know, you can do normalizing or denormalizing in SQL, and you can do it as well in NoSQL, because some NoSQL database allow you to do some sort of join. MongoDB has something called DBref. Nicole, the Couchbase language, support joins. Cassandra doesn't support join. I don't know why, but you can do materialized view. I mean, I know why, because it's distributed and it's too costly to do join on distributed system because it's slow because network latency. But that's a topic for another talk. So basically, you can normalize or denormalize with any database. It's not a technological choice, in a sense. It's more of a business choice. You decide what you want to do. Now, what about the age difference? RDBMS have been around for 40 years. NoSQL database are just gaining traction for the past 10 years. So, you know, can NoSQL database catch up about 40 years of people working on query planning or security features and everything? Well, the straight answer is not really, not yet. There's a level of maturity that will come up to NoSQL database, especially on the security side of things. I mean, we try very hard to sell NoSQL database to banking. Banking, you have this ops department that's very conservative, and you know, if you propose them a database, then you need to have the exact same security feature than RDBMS, and that's not the case yet. NoSQL store are getting better at this, but still a little lagging behind. Now there's the whole ecosystem story. RDBMS have lots of tool, reporting tool, you know, that you can plug directly into your database. It's not the case with NoSQL because, well, they don't use or used to use a common language that is SQL. Because every RDBMS supports SQL, you can plug it to Tableau or Excel or Talend or whatever pretty easily. The NoSQL data store on the other end all have their own language, but they all also support a JDBC or a DBC driver, so they all have access to all this stuff, which is great. So edge difference, it depends for one very good reason. RDBMS are this old thing that's been thought for a monolithic application. On the other end, distributed databases are more for microservices architecture because application logic goes to the application layer. It's more agile. There's no schema and everything. So it kind of depends on what you want to do. And of course, one of the things I haven't touched about today, but I actually talked about that yesterday, was NoSQL Store. Most have reactive driver based on Eric Java, reactive stream, blah, blah, blah. It's not the case on DBMS because it hasn't been made for that. So there's a choice to be made. So basically, boundaries are between SQL and NoSQL, or between RDBMS and NoSQL database, are getting thinner and more blurry. And it's not getting better in the sense that it will get more blurry and more thin. The difference will disappear, and everything is going to converge into one thing. And it's going to be data platform. And you already hear NoSQL vendor talk about data platform, mostly because they're trying to sell you something. But that's also because they are supporting more and more and more way of growing stuff or using your data. So they're doing this because, you know, it's a world of trade-off. You need to make choices based on all the questions that we've saw today. And they're doing this to offer more flexibility to you, developers. Or, oops, I'm out of time. Thank you very much. Do we have time for question? Well, do we have question? No? No, we have one here.
Just a note about the age of NoSQL systems. There was an article from Oracle employee, I think, that he said that MySQL code base is just a mess, and actually nobody understands what's going on there. So young age of NoSQL is just like a bonus for them. And about Couchbase, you said that it's mobile, at least going to be mobile.
So Couchbase, is it mobile? Couchbase is no SQL, no mobile, and no cache. in the sense that it's not only mobile. So it's not only SQL, we rookie value store, you can do SQL query. It's not only cache, because everything you do in Couchbase, I haven't talked about it, starts in RAM, so it's no cache. And it's mobile in the sense that we have something called Couchbase Mobile. And it's made of three things. It's made of Couchbase Server, which is the database. It's made of something else called the Sync Gateway, which is an application server that will do all the offline synchronization stuff for another piece called Couchbase Lite. Couchbase Lite is an embedded JSON database. It runs on a phone, it runs on a Raspberry Pi, on iOS, anything that runs a JVM. So it's a local JSON database. You can write views with the MapReduce stuff. But it's a proper local database, and it syncs automatically to Couchbase Server by doing REST call through this piece in the middle called the Sync Gateway. So that's why I said it's no mobile. We have we do offline sync just like Parse or Realm or what Firebase used to do in the beginning, but with a proper local database, not just a local cache.
Thank you.
Just one more question about some cases where you're using databases for statistical calculations, like reporting or some predictions or something like this. Which kind of database is most suitable in that case?
For analytics?
Yes.
It depends. Okay. Cassandra, I said, was super popular in the big data space. In the big data space, you do heavy analytics using Hadoop, or you do, traditionally, or you do real-time analytics using something like Spark. And usually when you do this kind of analytics, you do need a schema, or at least a SQL-like queryability. Cassandra is great because you have a table. Edgebase is great because you have a table. If you have a table, you have columns. You have columns, you have a schema. So column data store are a family that's very well fitted to do analytics. And then for the case of Couchbase, we have this SQL-like language, and you can do, I'm going to say, light analytics using NQL, because you can do join and everything just with SQL. You can use a JDBC driver to plug it into Tableau or any other reporting or analytics tool. And then there's something else I wanted to say. There's no straight answer, basically. They all have JDBC, so they all can do some sort of analytics. It depends on what you hear by analytics. Do you want real-time analytics? Then you can use Spark, and every NoSQL database have a plugin for Spark. Or maybe you want to do Hadoop because you don't need real-time stuff, and every database has a plugin for Hadoop. Everybody wants to do it. So basically, databases are on the operative side. They acquire or restitute data, and then most of the time you use another solution like Spark or Hadoop to do the actual analytics work, and then once you, when it's done, maybe send it back to the database to serve it to someone else. That's where Cachebase is going. We're going to add our own analytics layer next year. Thank you.